am Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor of computer science and psychology, and I study how people reason with data visualizations. Today, I wanted to talk about a potentially controversial topic, and it's why chart types don't matter as much as you think they do in data visualization. When you're starting out in data visualization, the first thing that people try to figure out what to do is which chart type they should use for a particular data set. And that is fine, but what I want to propose is that maybe there's something that is a little bit more important than the chart type, which is the encoding channel. So stick around if you want to learn what an encoding channel is, which encoding channels are better, and how to use them in your data visualizations. Okay, let's begin with an example. Here we have a data set that is showing the number of World Heritage sites in Norway, Denmark, and Sweden for 2 different years. Very simple data set from this really fantastic design group, and you can take a look at these visualizations that I'm about to show you and many more on their website. But here's this one data set, and here are 2 ways of visually representing the exact same data, the data I just showed you. On the left, we have this stacked bar. On the right, we have these kind of individual bars. Now, if I was to classify these 2 visualizations, I would call these both bar charts to some degree, this one being a stacked bar chart and this being regular bar charts. But what I wanted to break down, rather than just the chart type, which in some ways are very similar, is the encoding channels that are used in each of these visualizations. So what is an encoding? An encoding is the way that we take raw data and we map it onto a visual variable like color, position, size, etc. So when you have visualizations like this, they might be a very similar type, chart type, but they can use different encoding channels. So let's break down the encoding channels that we have in these 2 visualizations here. Okay, first, both of them are using the encoding channel of color. They're using color to represent different things. In this version, we're representing different sites with color, and we have a different luminance representing the different years. Here, we just have the different countries represented in color. Okay, so they both have color going on. The next thing that they have in terms of an encoding channel is position. So the one on the left, the way you'd understand position is that it is encoding data with relative locations. So in both of these 2 years, we have this baseline, and then from the baseline, we have a height element here. So for 2014, we're looking at 5. For 2022, we're looking at 8, both for Norway. In order to interpret this visualization, what you can do is simply look at this position here and here, relative to this baseline, and the relative part matters a great deal. So what you don't have to do is compare the area, you don't have to compare the line length, you can just look at where this position is here and get the information of which one is bigger, okay? We also have position going on in the other as well. It is actually the primary encoding channel where each of these different dots and lines are indicated based on position because they have the same baseline. So you don't have to actually care this length, you can just look at the position, okay? This is gonna be important in just a second. So the next thing that the one on the left has going on is also length, line length. In order to interpret the difference for Denmark from 2014 to 2022, you have to look at the length from this point to this point and compare that to the length from this point to this point. Of course, it has the number also on there, so you don't have to do the calculation, but the actual encoding that this is using is length. It's not using position because you have to look at 2 relative positions to sort that out. It's actually using the length. That is not the case with any of these over here. So this particular stacked bar chart is using both position and length. Now, before I move on, I just want to say that there's many different strategies for interpreting visualizations like these. You might be a person who actually attempts to calculate the overall length, but that's not what it depends on. And research finds that what we primarily do is, rather than looking at the length, we look at the position of these. And the same goes for this other one up here. Now, the reason I'm harping so much on the difference between position and length is that the science of data visualization has explicitly broken down the different abilities of those encoding channels to communicate information effectively. Here we have this fantastic figure that was in Tamara Munsner's book, which I highly recommend, and it summarizes a great deal of the empirical research that has been done on these different channels. And a great deal of research starting all the way back in the 70s has been conducted to determine which of these different encoding channels are more effective for displaying different values. But what we have going on here is that The top we have the most effective, and at the bottom we have the least effective. So if you want to know what is the most effective encoding channel, or magnitude, and when we're talking about magnitude, it's a continuous value, then you're looking at position on a common scale, position on unaligned scale, which is what we were just showing you in the previous example when they were unaligned, and then it goes in descending order. If you have a categorical value or different kind of groups, then you can look at these identity channels. And one of the major ones that is the most effective is spatial region, followed by color, hue, and downwards. Okay. So this is really a summary of a large body of work that empirically evaluates the different capacities of these encoding channels. So if we return to our two visualization types and we're thinking about the ability of encoding channels to communicate information as easily and effectively as possible, what we see here is that the ones that rely predominantly on position, which would be these, would be more likely to be effective than the ones that also require you to interpret length. Okay, so this is one way you can start to say, if I want to make the most effective visualization possible, try to focus on using encoding channels that are the most effective according to empirical research, as is illustrated in this figure. Okay, let's do another example for fun. I'd like you to pause the video and look at these two visualizations and try to determine which encoding channels they use and which you think would be most successful based on this summary of empirical work that we have here. All right, what do you think? Well, when I'm looking at this one on the left, I think by and large, we have color, of course. But I think the major encoding channel that we're looking at is this area size judgment. It's about in the middle of effectiveness. You could certainly have more effective visual encoding channels if you work higher up, but it's kind of in the middle. And when you're doing these kind of visual comparisons, it's fairly reasonable to compare them across. I would say you have to be a little bit careful when you're having people compare area, because some area judgments are easier than others. If you have very predictable shapes like circles, they can be a little bit easier than more irregular shapes to compare the area of. But in any case, we have area encodings here with color. Now over here, we predominantly have a combination of color saturation and luminance, where for 2014 and 20, if you're looking at it for Sweden, you're having to look at the brightest red compared to darker red, and then look up the values on this legend here, okay? So that is lower in terms of our effectiveness, and I would argue that this is much harder to interpret than this. This is the exact same data that is being encoded for Sweden here and Sweden here, but we have this luminance channel being represented for the higher value and a brighter color and a darker color for the smaller value. And that can be very hard to interpret. So our figure over here that predicts the effectiveness of an encoding channel seems to align with my interpretation of these visualizations, where this color and luminance, using that as the primary driver, is actually a little bit more difficult than 2D area judgments. And that is my pitch for why focusing more on the effectiveness of an encoding channel is more important than focusing on which type of chart that you should use. If you are utilizing the most effective encoding channels, in some ways you can do that with a whole range of different charts. I wanted to close with this example from the same data set and say, here we have maps. If you wanted to call it a chart type, you'd probably designate these as maps. And each of these different maps is using vastly different encoding channels. So even within a chart type, you can use a wide range of encoding channels. And by using the figure that I showed in the previous slide, you can start to predict which will be more effective in terms of being easy and accessible for people to understand. I hope this introduction into encoding channels was useful. My main goal here was to get you introduced into the concept. There's a lot more to say about how and why and when to use encoding channels, but if you start with that figure that talks about the expressiveness and effectiveness of those coding channels, you will be on your way to making better data visualizations.